Good evening. Welcome to service. Let's get these announcements out of the way so we can begin our worship service. Don't forget, Sunday school and Sunday evening services will resume this coming Sunday. Sunday school will be at 10 a.m. and it's going to be down in the fellowship hall. So the adult Sunday school class will be in the fellowship hall. That way, people coming in for the regular service can come on in and sit down, and there won't be any gathering in the hallway. So be here for that next Sunday. And also, Sunday evening service will begin at normal time at 6:30. That's this coming Sunday. That'll start back. Don't forget, we're planning to have a trunk or treat on Saturday, October 31st from 3 to 5. We do ask that you decorate the back of your vehicle in biblical theme. Then at 5, there will be a bonfire and roasting hot dogs after the trunk or treat. Around 6:30 p.m., we will ask everyone to gather around for prayer for our nation and for revival atmosphere in our church services. We strongly encourage everyone to attend and be in one accord and like-minded so we can see a great move of God. And also on Saturday at 11 a.m., there'll be a prayer march our church is doing. That's going to be at the Washington waterfront. It'll begin at 11 a.m. that we'll meet at the lighthouse on the waterfront. Encourage everyone to come and join that. We do have Allie Good Church of God face mask available. I was told they're one for $5 or three for $15. So don't forget to get that. Go ahead and get your mask. So you get a deal if you get three of them. Anyway, don't forget the Christmas child shoebox. That's going to be for the Samaritan's Purse. And the last collection day for the boxes will be Sunday, November 15th. We'll be doing a live nativity this year on December the 18th through the 20th. If you'll be willing to participate in a non-speaking part, please sign up in the sanctuary. And also, we are having Christmas practice for our Christmas program during Children's Church, so make sure your child is here for that at each time they have Children's Church down there so they can be getting ready for the Christmas program.
Man, good to have everybody in the house of the Lord tonight. Amen.
We're going to sing a song tonight. Many times we're only singing it at Easter.
With me and talks with me along the time.
can be seated, everybody. Amen. Lord's house, we greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior. I love to ask people, how many folks are glad they're saved this evening? Amen. Glad to be born again on our way to heaven. Amen. You're not perfect. I'm not perfect, but we serve a resurrected, perfect Christ. Amen. And he can help us to live this walk. And I was watching some videos, singing videos, I think the other night. I'm trying to think where, and I can't remember her name now, but she sang, "I've come too far to turn back." Amen. I'm not going to sing that, by the way, but I it was about a 22-minute, she was at Jimmy Swaggart's place, and I can't remember her name. Who? Nancy Harmon. Sang it for 22 minutes. I've come too far to turn back now, amen. But how many of you know that's what we've done? We've come too far, amen. Want to go to the Lord in prayer, and a lot of things we need to bring up and talk about, and the Lord knows all of them. We have many people here, different situations where folks are hospitalized. I do want to, while I've got this mask in front of me, please, on our prayer march, we want everybody to wear a mask, if you would, if you could and can. Please wear a mask, and we want to be good citizens out there on our prayer march, and for us to come together and be in close proximity like we're going to have to be in that march. And so if you're comfortable and you can do that, we really encourage you to do that. We do want to make sure, it's a big step for us to start back Sunday nights in Sunday school here, and that means we're back to pre-COVID services and times of services. And there are, as you've noticed, if you've read in the papers and online, we're averaging around 2,000 cases a day, new cases in North Carolina. So we want to be careful, okay? And so we're asking, please, try to maintain social distancing in our church, in our services, the best that you can. Families, I know you're together, that kind of thing. Please don't be offended if somebody doesn't shake your hands and want to hug your neck. Please give everybody distance when you're talking to them, okay? Just what the CDC is asking. There are at least three churches that I know about in Beaufort County that has had outbreaks. Dear saint of God, Betty Cutler, passed away, went to the Assemblies of God. She and her husband attended here on Sunday nights a lot because they didn't have Sunday night services. They had a number of cases over there. I think things are going better for them. But Sister Betty had some underlying cases, but she got the COVID, and they're going to bury her tomorrow. So we need to be careful. Thank God for the opportunity to be back in the house of God and to worship God and come together. But we're still in the middle of this thing, and I want us to pray. Let's ask God to protect us. You know, we have not because we ask not. Amen. And so I do. I pray, God, we're no better than any other church, but we're just asking for your protection. So on that note, let's remember Gerald Wayne Willard. He's still battling, and he needs our prayers, and the family needs our prayers. Betty Hayes still needs our prayers for what she's going through. Francis Ford's husband is in the hospital. He had a heart attack. We want to remember him. Brother Lynn, it was good to see Brother Linwood. He wasn't able to be with us Sunday for us all that. Amen. And continue to pray for him. They're still working on all that sinuses things. If you have an outspoken need tonight, would you let it be known at this time? Anybody have an outspoken need? Sister. Sister Nellie, remember Sister Nellie. Somebody else tonight? Anybody else? Amen. Let's pray one for another. Pray for our services this weekend. I'm excited about coming back together on Sunday nights. Amen. And we invite you to be back with us on Sunday night. And I'm looking forward to, you know, we don't judge it now by the, we never judge it by the crowds because we don't want 300 people to show up. But if they do, we're still going to have church. I take that back. I don't know what I would do if 300 people. I might have a heart attack if 300 people showed up. But we are excited about coming back together on the house of God on Sunday night. So look forward to that. Unspoken needs, let it be known by uplifted hands. I have many. I have lost loved ones that I want to see come to the Lord. How about you tonight? Amen. We're going to pray the prayer tonight, and then when we're done, we're just going to ask everybody that we want to give in the offerings at this time, just come on up and after we pray and give in your offerings. And starting after tonight's service, We're also going to place some baskets at the back of the sanctuary for future services. That way you can give as you come in or go out, and you don't have to come up. Not everybody's comfortable doing that. So that's something we'll start doing also too. So if you would you join in prayer with me at this time? Let's approach the throne room of grace. Heavenly Father, we humbly bow, Lord. What a privilege. God, it's always an honor and a privilege to come together with the people of God to lift up the God of this house. Lord, we bring our prayer needs before you. We come, Lord God, with our hearts heavy, our hands full, Lord. Lord, voices, Lord, crying out to the true and the living God and praying, God, that you would move, Lord. God, there are people here tonight that have things in their bodies, mind, soul, and spirit. God, we've lifted up names. Hands have been raised always. Every time we come together, it signifies that we need you to move, Lord. We let you know, God, even though you already know, God, we know that you're a God that hears and answers prayers. Lord, we pray, Lord, for this service tonight, our service, our children, classes going on in the back. Lord, all that's done in here, the songs, the worship, the praise, the altar time, the preaching, God. And Lord, we want to be a house of prayer. We want to be a place where we can come together, and when this group of people grabs a hold of the horns of the altar, we can truly touch God. So Lord, tonight come down and fill this place, Lord. Touch your people, Lord God, in a special way. We'll give you praise, honor, and glory. And let everybody say amen and amen. God bless you as you give. Just come from everywhere and give tonight. Amen.
I just want to start out by saying that I am so, so excited to be able to do this song for y'all tonight, and I'm a little humbled and a little blessed as well that I get to do it. I heard it earlier this year, kind of in the beginning of COVID, and it's a new release. It just came out this year, and I thought, what a fitting song for the time that we're in. The church has been through a lot, not just our church, but the church as a whole, and the world's in a bit of a mess, but you know, the name of this song is called The Story I'll Tell, and I think about my mom a lot when I listen to this song. And, you know, as Christians, we can be kind of put under magnifying glass sometimes when the world knows that we've given some sort of bad news and we're facing a struggle, a trial, a storm, whatever it is, because they want to see what we're going to do, how we're going to react, and what we're going to say. And I know when we first got the news about my mom's cancer diagnosis, although the doctors were positive about it, it was still a shock. It was unexpected. It's not something you ever want to hear. But after the shock, it was just almost an immediate peace that she's going to be okay and that there's going to be such a testimony that comes out of this. And, you know, there's a part of this song that says, I'll testify of the seas that we've crossed, the waters you parted, and the waves that I walked.
Oh, touch your God.
And I thought, how many times can God just snap his fingers and just make it so much easier? He parts the waters and he just makes it easier to walk through.
Yes.
He could have made that tumor, that mass disappear, but he didn't. And she's got to walk the waves. And it doesn't matter. This isn't just for her. You know, this applies to any situation, whatever storm or trial you might be facing or going through. Sometimes he does make it easy, but sometimes he doesn't. You have to walk the waves, and I think we all know how relentless waves can be. They just pound one right after another. But he's laid out a path, and that's what is important, and that you trust him enough to take the path that he's laid out for you, and that you give him the glory, the honor, and the praise every step of the way, because he has been there, he will be there, and he's not going to leave you. And I just pray that this just touches someone tonight. If it's just for me, just so I can get it out of my system, because I just love this song so much, then I'm okay with that. But I just pray that it does touch someone tonight as much as it does me.
That is left is highest praises.
when there wasn't enough provider. And I'll sing a song of the seas that we crossed, the waters you parted, and the waves that I walked. Singing, oh, 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 my God did not fail, never ever fail me. And oh, 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 it's the story I'll tell. And oh, 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 I know it is well. And oh, 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 it's the story I'll tell. The story I'll tell is the story I'll tell.
Amen. If you would stand with us, Sister Elizabeth is going to lead us in a song we sing around here occasionally, but my husband asks for it every week. He says, when are you going to sing that song? When are you going to sing that song? And Sister Elizabeth doesn't have her guitar here tonight. We do it in the key of D.
Help me out.
But we've sung it. If you remember when what was the brothers' names that came? The McGregors? And they sang it, and you know the young guy that sang so beautifully, and we just all kind of fell in love with it, and I think Brother Jethro would ask him to sing it every night. But it is a beautiful message. Our music has been different tonight, but it's been every song has just had a great message, and this one is no different. How deep the Father's love for me.
How fast
praise the Lord. Would you lift your hands and bless the Lord? Amen. Father, we worship you tonight, God. Father, we worship you tonight. Come on, let's worship him tonight, church. We honor you, Lord. We bless you tonight, God. We've been ushered into your presence, Lord. Oh, King of glory, we adore you tonight. Hallelujah. Oh, Lamb of God, we worship you, Lord. Oh, our soon coming King, we bow before you tonight, Lord. Praise and honor, might and dominion belong unto him. Glory and honor and riches unto thee, O God. We bless your name. We worship you, Lord. Father, you're high and lifted up, O Lord. We bless you tonight, God. Wonderful Savior. Mighty God, everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, the Ancient of Days, the first and the last, amen. The author and the finisher of our faith. Oh, hallelujah. The great God of Israel, amen. We worship you, Jehovah God. We bless you tonight. Oh, we worship you tonight. Hallelujah. Oh, we bless your name tonight. Hallelujah. We worship you tonight. Come on, for just a few more moments, just help me enter in. Lord, we bless you tonight, God. Jesus. Oh, we bless you tonight, God. Oh, we worship you tonight, God. Oh, we bless you, Jesus. Bless your name. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Come on and worship him in the beauty of holiness tonight. Hallelujah. We often pray, Holy Spirit comes, and then when he comes, we're in a rush to do something. Lord, we just honor you this right now. We bless you, Lord. Just don't stir us tonight, God, but change us. Oh, we magnify him. Bless your name. Bless your name, Jesus. Bless your name. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Hallelujah. Praise your name. Glory to God. Lamb of God. Lamb of God, Jesus. It always feels so right to worship him. You ever thought about that? It always feels perfect to worship him. You know why? Because we are created to worship him. Amen. That's why you're on this planet. He brought you into existence so that your life would be a sacrifice, a life of worship, praise, and adoration to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Would you remain standing as we read one passage of Scripture? Thank all of y'all for your worship. The songs that were sung, Nicole, beautiful job on that song. All of it was beautiful. Proverbs 29:2. The word of the Lord reads, "When the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice. But when the wicked beareth rule, the people mourn." Heavenly Father, I don't even want to attempt to minister the word of God without your help. So right now, God, I'm asking, pleading for the precious blood of Jesus to be applied. Father, for the Holy Spirit to just fall upon me, Lord. Use me for thine glory. Lord, let me speak words, Lord, that are directed by you, God. Give, Lord, an ear for your people to hear, a heart to receive, Lord God, a mind and to comprehend the things that we'll be discussing and talking of tonight. We'll give you praise. Everybody said amen and amen. It is so good to be in the house of the Lord with you tonight. I'm going to share some things. You can be seated, and I'm going to share some things tonight. Obviously, we're on the threshold of a lot going on in our country. Everybody's aware of that. There's, again, with all the things that we are facing, number one, as a nation, number two, as a church, And I look at all of the prophetic voices that are out there, one saying this and one saying that. And sometimes it can be a little, I don't want to say the word chaotic, but sometimes you don't know how to go through all that's being said. But thank God there's a book written right here, amen, that you can turn to, and it's got the answers, amen. Praise God for the Word of God. So I want to talk for a little while. I want to jump off of this scripture here, and this is very, very simple Word of God tonight. When the righteous rule or in authority, people rejoice, and when the wicked beareth rule, the people mourn. And so I want to jump off of that and talk about this upcoming election just a moment. I'm not going to get political and get into all of that, but I want to speak to what is going on in America and what we're getting ready to face. We are being placed in front of us is an opportunity for the nation to go to the polls and to vote. Hopefully what we believe are Christian Judeo world views or world principles. And so we are faced with a choice. One of the campaign ads, and I believe it's part of Biden's campaign slogans, is that it's a battle for the soul of America. And I thought how profound that was, that someone who believes the way that he believes and who stands for the things that he stands for. How many of you know tonight, church, it has never been more clear where we are as a nation as far as a division? If you vote one way, you're voting this way. If you're voting the other way. And listen, let me say something. No party is right about everything. No candidate is perfect. But what we have to do as a people of God, we have to be able to discern and to view the way we vote and how we vote. And it's so important. Now, I saw something on social media somewhere. Is it that after the election, God's still going to be God? He's still going to rule and reign, amen. He's still coming back. God's word is still the same, amen. Jesus Christ is still the resurrected Son of God. Amen. None of that is going to change, but I do believe that the people now, and as Biden's campaign put it, it is a battle for the soul of the nation, and we've got to realize is that there are a group of people whose, I believe, is the one, their ultimate aim is to silence the voice of the righteous. Absolutely, to silence the voice of what is right versus what is wrong, what is good versus what is evil. I speak often of Isaiah 5:20. Woe unto them that call good evil and evil good. If we've ever lived in a day or hour, church, where what is evil and wicked is celebrated as what is good and what is righteous, holy, and just is looked at as what is evil. How in the world did we get here? I'm not so sure that I'm qualified to answer that question, but I am qualified to say, make this statement, we're here. We are definitely here. So what we have to do, I want to just say a few things about the election, and I'll get into the scripture part. You have a right to vote. You have a responsibility to vote. Yes, you do. And I believe that the pulpits, and they say, well, there's no place for this in the pulpits. Let me tell you something. I'm tired of namby-pamby, wimpy, backbone-less preachers that won't get up and take a stand for what is right, amen, according to this election, wanting to patty cake around this. I call them a bunch of spiritual sissies. They're afraid to stand up and declare that as the church of the living God, we get a lot of this about, the character of our president and all of these things. But let me say something. Irregardless of that, we must look at what this man is proposing to do, what he's saying, what laws that he's pushing, and the things that he's trying to do. Did anybody see him when he did that speech about the new justice? He talked about her background in the church. He talked about, and I know she's Catholic, and I wish that she was a born-again, hopefully she is a born-again Catholic, but I'm just so glad that he's willing to put people in place who will sit. When the Bible said, when the righteous rule, the people rejoice. But when, because she stands for what is righteous, for her biblical, Judeo-biblical worldview, the other side has screamed and yelled and said, what a wicked, what an evil person this is. This is where we're living, people. You have a right to vote. You have a responsibility to vote. You have a reason to vote. This nation was founded on Judeo-Christian principles. It was not founded on this left-wing, socialist, God-hating, atheistic philosophy that this opposing group of people that are out there, it was not founded on that principle. I watched one senator, he was incensed and inflamed. He was so upset that this new justice would uphold the original meaning of the Constitution. I don't know if you saw that. I think it was Markey up from Massachusetts or somewhere. Don't quote me on that. And I looked at it and I read it again, and there he is. The very intent that the Constitution was wrote on, this Barrett woman says, I am willing and intend to interpret the law in the way that it was written. And for that, he said that was racist, that was bigoted, that was this and that. And I thought to myself, what in the world is wrong with people today? And I'm telling you, if the church and if people that believe that when the righteous rule, the people will rejoice, if we'll get mobilized, if we'll come together, amen. Number one, let's pray and seek the face of God and repent for the sins of the nation and then go to the polls and make a difference and vote, amen. We wouldn't be in the shape that we're in now. They said there's 80 to 100 million evangelicals in America. Where are we at? Let's get out and vote. Let's get out here and let's vote Judeo-Christian worldview, amen. Let's vote righteously, morally. Let's vote for the family, for family principles. Listen, church, I know I'm preaching to the choir tonight, but I'm telling you, it's time. I've never seen, even as long as I've been now in the ministry, I've never seen the pulpit so silent on issues that are confronting our nation and the moral fabric and the righteous principles that we're founded on, and the pulpits remain silent. Let's call it what it is, amen. It's called a spade, amen. I'm telling you, that junk that's coming down the pipe, that this crowd that wants to unseat our president and take over in power, stand for everything that we are against. And are against everything that we stand for. And I'm telling you right now, I'm seeing, it's like pastors are printing articles and putting on podcasts and why we're not voting. And why, I read one article the other day, the pastor, I'm leaving my church because they're supporting Donald Trump. But bless your heart, man, if you're going to support Joe Biden, you ain't got no business pastoring in the first place. Dear God, this man has gotten up and said he stands for abortion, gay marriage. Come on here, church. Dear Lord, they want to give. And here we are in the church, in the pulpits. That's what I'm saying. Men like myself and women who mount and come behind these sacred desks and give an opportunity not to be political and not to try to sway one person or that way, but simply speak the truth in love and declare God's word and his right. God is a righteous and a holy God, and he's looking for a righteous and a holy people. And we're to vote biblical principles. See, the Judeo, and I want to spend a few minutes on here, the Judeo-Christian worldview is simply that, is taking the Old Testament and the New Testament and combining that in looking and setting our principles, our morals, our codes, our truths, our belief system, and basing it all on that world view. And do you know our nation was founded by men who had this world view? I'm telling you, if those men were alive today, and that's physically impossible, they would be absolutely dumbfounded, shocked at what we're seeing here today. First of all, let me tell you what. So I'm glad you asked. What are Judeo-Christian worldviews that made America great to begin with? It's men and women who left England and other countries and came here for religious freedoms. And when they came here, they established a nation that was based on the Word of God. I don't have time to go into all the quotes of Abraham Lincoln, George Washington, many of our founding fathers. Some of them were not Christians, but all of them, if they weren't Christians, they were deists. They believed in God, not necessarily in Christ as Lord and Savior, but they believed in a creator. If anybody ever read the Constitution, anybody ever read the Bill of Rights, we have these inalienable rights, amen, to worship our creator. And these people that want to take over this nation, want to just do away with that, don't even believe in a creator church. Judeo-Christian values are simply, I'm going to give you 7 or 8 or 10 of them, depending on how much time we have. Number one, faith in a God. Not just any God, but the God. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Jehovah Jireh, the Lord God that provided, amen, the self-existing eternal one, the Holy One of Israel, Jehovah God. That is number one Judeo-Christian value and worldview. There is one God, amen, existing eternally in God the Father, Son, God the Holy Ghost, amen. There is no other God but Him. That's number one. When you have a Judeo-Christian worldview, that's what you believe. But the opposite of that, what these people believe. Now, some of them may say they have a belief in God. Even the Roman Catholic Church, the cardinal said Joe Biden couldn't come and take communion because he was such an apostate, such a reprobate, if you, an apostate. The taking of communion in the Catholic Church is a right given to those who are in good standing of the faith. And when those in authority tell you that you can't take it, that's pretty bad news. Even his own leadership in the Catholic Church won't even let Biden take communion because they know that he's a reprobate concerning the faith. But the Judeo-Christian worldview, the way we see the world through the lens of this Bible, is that there's only one God, and the God of Israel. They believe there's no God. It's just science and reason. There's some little blob was floating aimlessly in the ocean billions of years ago. Somehow got some fins and some, I don't know, gills. Swam around another billion years maybe. And then that little blob that got some gills and some fins finally made his way to dry land and somehow rolled or crawled or slithered up on the land, and then after a little while of billion years of slithering around, he got some feet and some hands, if you will, or some legs, and then he began to crawl around in another billion years or so, or 10 billion years. Then he got up and got it kind of standing upright, and I don't know how it all worked, but billions of years later, he turned into a monkey, and billions of years later, here I am. And they're going to mock us because we believe in a sovereign God that took the dust of the earth and formed it into a man and breathed into him the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Amen. That's what they believe, but we have a Judeo-Christian worldview, and we believe that God is the creator of life. Wow, and they think we're crazy. We believe through a Judeo-Christian worldview and looking through that lens that there is a universal truth, and that is the Word of God. Wow. This is absolute truth. That's what we believe. That's when you believe in Judeo-Christian views, a worldview, is that you believe that the Word of God is the absolute truth, the final say on all matters. Somebody say amen. The opposite of that is that truth can change. That truth is relative. That's what they believe. We believe truth cannot change. Say amen. It's not going to change for you. It's not going to change for the culture. It's not going to change because the church has said it's changed. God's word stands forever. They believe there is no absolute truth. That all truth is relative. In other words, whatever truth you want, Sister Shirley, Brother Ken, whatever truth you want, your truth is good. I've had people to tell me that when I've witnessed to them. That's your truth. Wait a minute, that's not my truth. That's the truth of God's word. But that's what they believe because they don't see the world the way that we see it. But you and I see it through the lens of a Judeo-Christian worldview. And this is so important because this is not only what America is founded on. This is what the justice and the righteousness and the holiness and the purity of God is founded on. All through Israel's history, and I don't have time to go into all of this. This is what guided ancient civilizations. They didn't have the New Testament, but they had these moral views that were based on, back then, say, the Ten Commandments. Even before Moses' time, did anybody remember Job? Job, they say, is one of the oldest books in the Bible. So he predates Moses and all of that. He never had a Bible. He didn't see the Ten Commandments. He never knew anything about the cross, never received the sweet baptism of the Holy Ghost. None of this, never had the Bible. You and I sit down with this in the morning and read and drink my coffee and just let the Lord bless me and talk to the Lord. He never had any of those things. But the Bible says that when the devil came and appeared before God, he said, "Have you considered my servant Job? Perfect, an upright, a mature man." And you know, I love this about this. He didn't have any of these things that we had, but he had a moral compass. He had principles. He didn't know anything about Jesus, but he said, "I know that my Redeemer lives." He said, "One day I shall see him." The truth was the truth then, it's the truth now, and it'll be the truth forever. Come on and say amen. They believe that truth can change, that truth is relative. We believe, as in the Judeo-Christian worldview, that God created the universe and everything in it. The opposite of that is what they believe, that everything just happened. Wow. One man said to believe that, you got to be able to believe that this world just came into an existence. I don't know about you, but I'm awed by God's creation. I'm awed when I think about how the human body functions. Wow. I mean, I could go, I got so many illustrations, but time won't allow me to. I'm awed by, and to think that it just all came into being by chance. One preacher said that's like taking the parts, taking all the nuts and bolts and wires and everything for a 747 jet and throwing them in a building and shaking up all the parts, and out would pop a 747. There's about as much chance of that happening as this world. Let me tell you something. God spoke it, and it came into existence. That's what we believe. That's what the Bible says, amen. And from a Judeo-Christian worldview, that's what we accept. This is important. Because this other crowd, this anti-Christ, this anti-God crowd, does not even acknowledge that there is a God, a creator God. The heavens declare his glory. Amen. The Bible lets us know that through this Judeo-Christian worldview that we view through as a lens in the way we live, that God gives life, and all life is precious in his sight. Even the unborn. That's how we view it. All life is sacred. All races are sacred. I'm a big advocate, and I preach this everywhere I've been, that we prejudice is a sin. Every man, every person, black, white, brown, whatever color, is all created in the image of God. Man is created. Our race is sacred. Our mind, our imagination is sacred. We are the temple of the Holy Ghost. But see, the world sees this quite the very opposite. See, society in their worldview as society decides who lives or dies. You say, really? Yeah. Anybody have heard of abortion? Abortion, which is a blot on our nation. From 1972 or 3, I always get it mixed up, Roe versus Wade. From that point when abortion became the law of the land in America, nearly 60 to 70 million children in their mother's womb have lost their life. You know why? Because this other crowd who don't see it the way we see it or don't look through the lens of a Judeo-Christian worldview look as life is not sacred. Let me tell you something. There are European countries that allow old people to commit suicide. They are assisted suicide. In other words, they're in some of the Sweden and Norway and in those countries. I can't remember what they call that region now. But in that region, there are laws that when you want to leave out of here, you're free to do so. They encourage that. I believe that there are death camps coming to America. I believe that's coming. Where when people will, what do you mean by that? Well, they will, society, when this crowd ever gets in control, they won't value life the way we value. See, when we're over there today and visiting, I'm not going to go into detail, but it's a beautiful thing to see a family come together when somebody's getting ready to leave this world. I remember, especially growing up as a boy, and most of us still believe this way, that when a family member got sick, that person, when they got old and was getting ready to leave this world, he'd come. You brought grandmama home into your house, and you waited on her and took care of her. I know everybody can't do that, and some of the physical and medical needs won't dictate that. And thank God for assisted living and nursing. I don't mean anything by that, but follow what I'm saying. There was such a respect for life. That life meant something. It didn't matter if it was 90 years old and in a fetal position and couldn't take care of themselves or bathe themselves. Come on now and help me just a minute. Life is sacred. That person's life meant something. But this crowd, when they ever get a hold of this thing, they'll decide you're not worthy of life anymore, of spending any more money on or any more insurance or any more medicine. This is coming to America. It's already here. Because they don't see the world through the same lens that we do. Life is not safe. When you can take a baby out of that crowd I'm talking about, and basically the Democratic Party, just in case anybody online ain't read between the lines yet. That crowd sees no problem with having a child delivered completely out of the body except for the head. And then having a pair of forceps stuck into that skull of that child. I know this is hard. And then a vacuum to vacuum. You think that when that crowd rules, the people will rejoice? There is no regard for human life. When somebody says that there is nothing wrong with seeing a child completely out of the mother's womb, laying on a table, nothing but the head inside of the womb of their mother, and then that child's life is taken and then delivered and discarded as but a piece of trash. But we believe that when conception takes place, God calls a human being into life, into being. And that life is sacred. Their view, society should decide who lives or dies. We believe through a Judeo-Christian worldview based on the Word of God that people are born with a sinful nature and need redemption. They believe that people basically are just inherently good. No, they're not. They're none good. No, not one. We've all sinned and came short of the glory of God. I see just like the Judeo-Christian worldview, the Bible teaches we're all born with a sinful nature and we need redemption. Even the best of us here tonight, the most godly, the most sanctified, the most mature, the most, I'll just give you the props tonight. There's somebody in here, whoever you are, and I'm not going to take that position, but you're probably the best Christian in this building. But even if you are, you still have a sinful nature. Come on here. But they will teach that basically everybody inherently is good. That is a lie from the pits of hell. We are wretched, even the best that we can do. Our righteousness is but as a filthy rag. The best that we can do within ourselves, we need the blood of Jesus to wash away the sins. Amen. Oh, praise God. Oh, can we just go back for a moment when the blood of Jesus was applied for the first time and cleansed us from our sins. Amen. Woo! We believe through the Word of God and the Judeo-Christian worldview that we are accountable to God. This old body is going to die. It's going to get... If you live, you can live healthy all to be 100 years old, but at some point, unless the Lord comes back, this body is going to give up and something's going to happen. But the soul and spirit are eternal. We believe that. That's what the Bible teaches. And we'll, you know, I say this all the time. This is something that's been in a fabric of throughout my ministry, is that to warn people, to tell people, to encourage people, you're going to stand before God. But see, God's going to reward the good and punish the wicked. But they believe that everything ends at death. I've witnessed to many people over the years, and I've got a bunch more, but I'm going to try to wrap it up. I've witnessed to many people over the years. And a man has said to me, when I die, that's it. That's everything. He said, when you die, that's it. You cease to exist. There's nothing else. That's the end of it. I said, well, let me address that. I said, if you're right, I'm still going to live my life the way I believe. I'm going to believe that trying to live a good, sanctified, holy life, one that will please God, one that will bring honor and glory to God. That's the major goal of my life, to live a life that is pleasing to God. I said, so when I die, even though I've lived by these things, according to what you believe, that when I die, I cease to exist. So if you're right, I don't have anything to lose. But if the Word of God is right, and you live your life any way you want to live, when you leave this world, you'll find out that there is a God to stand before, and it's cost you everything. See, I don't have anything to lose because I believe this is right. I'm saved. But you believe that when it's over, that's why they don't, when you don't fear eternity and you don't fear God, the Bible said the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. I love God. I serve God. I'm a child of God. But oh, on that great and dreadful day, I've got to stand before Him and give an account for the good and the bad that I've done. That's what we believe. God allows spiritual warfare between good and evil. Yes, He does. Anybody notice that? There is a battle going on. But God and His crowd win. Somebody say amen. They only believe in an opposite. I'm sorry. They only believe in a physical world, nothing spiritual. I'm going to tell you something. When some of this wickedness that we see, and I know it's getting a little late, hang on just a minute or two. When we see the vile wickedness out here in this world going on, how can we not think that there is some spiritual demonic force behind it? When a grown man can take a child 4 or 5 years old and drag it out in the woods and abuse it and slit its throat and throw it in a ditch and leave and go to McDonald's and order a chicken McNugget. Something is wrong. Oh, I could give you. I don't want to be. I didn't know this is hard, and I don't want to be gratuitous with the vile. There's so much vile wickedness going on. Human trafficking, sexual immorality. There is a battle raging for the very souls of mankind all over this world. And to deny that is utter ignorance. A few more things. The family is the building block of society. God has entrusted us, and I don't want to make nobody mad, but God didn't call the church to teach your youngins about the Bible. We are a supplement. You are the primary educator of your children, of the things of God. Yes, you are. No, I never get any greater thrill as a parent when someone will come to me over the years, it's happened since we've been here, and brag on my youngin. She knows a lot about the Bible. Well, of course she does. We're trying to teach it to her while she's young and raise her, because we know that it's life or death. Family is the most important building block of society, and parents should raise their kids in the fear and the admonition of the Lord. But this crowd believes that the government should raise and educate our kids. That scares me to death. And when they get in power and they control everything, that's what's going to happen. Marriages say, we believe that marriage is sacred. It's a lifelong union between one man and one woman for life. That's God's. Now, whoa, wait a minute. Now, you step. No, let me tell you something. Divorce is not the unpardonable sin. It's affected all of us, every family. It's affected my family. God hates divorce. That's what the book says, because it tears away the fabric of a family. But thank God for reconciliation, for healing.
I ain't got no help.
Thank God for it. Amen, that God will touch and bless and help. Come on, church. But this crowd says, amen, that marriage is not between a man and a woman. This marriage has been redefined to mean just about anything. We're coming to this point where they're going to, the pedophile crowd, one day they're going to push. Maybe God help us. They're going to, it's coming. It's coming. They're grown men that want to marry children. California just eased some of the restrictions and the penalties on pedophiles in California. Yes, sir. It's in the books already. And what they're going to try to do, just like they normalized same-sex marriage and all these other, you know, there was this show, I never watched it. It was called Sister Wives. And it was on something on TV. I just saw the announcement on something. A man married two sisters. Is he crazy? I'll tell you right now, one woman, that's enough. Thank you, women. I'm not being mean now. I know, let me say it, one man is enough. Lord, I'm getting in trouble. We'll move on here. But the Judeo-Christian worldview is one man for one woman for life. That's the perfect God's plan. And I thank God for God. His mercy and his reconciliation and forgiveness and cleansing and touch, because God can take something that's broken and make something beautiful out of it again. Amen. That's a good place to give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Amen. We believe that sex is only for marriage between a man and a woman. Well, what kind of talk? Well, that's what we believe. That's what the Bible teaches. But you know, out there, anything and everything goes. I got one more thing and I'm going to close. You can come on back, Sister Ellen. You know, the Bible says to love your enemies. Pray for them that despitefully use you. Isn't that what it says? Love your enemies. Well, you know, that other crowd will tolerate anything and everybody and every opposing view but ours. Did you hear me? That crowd will get together, don't make no difference who they are. Antifa, Black Lives Matter, communist, you name whatever group of scallywags, they'll all come together, lock arms, sing Kumbaya. We're all in this thing together. We're united. We're tolerant, we're inclusive, we're for everybody, but people that believe the way we do. That shouldn't be lost on us. Because you know why? We see things through this Judeo-Christian worldview. Would you stand? I'll close. We'll pray and we'll let you go. I appreciate you enduring this. We've seen something. I'm going to mention one more thing, and then I'll say this. I have one more statement to close. We've seen this happen in this generation. The morals of this nation are absolutely in the ditch. We have lived, those of us that are alive now, we have lived to see pornography come into the mainstream of American life. What was once confined in a seedy store down in some inner city on some dark alleyway, what could be obtained through maybe a isolated drive-in movie, now is at our fingertips. Everywhere. And this crowd wants to make it that it's okay. Come on. What God calls an abomination, they call it okay. But I'm so glad that I'm not blinded to these facts, that I got my view set on things above and not on things of this earth. I want to close with this statement. My life, talking about me, Gary Bateman. My values, my morals, the truths, the principles that I live, the conduct that I do myself, the way I conduct myself, the way I view eternity, all of these things are based or seen through the lens of a Judeo-Christian world view. God, one day, is going to clean this mess up. And I know one thing. I am determined to be on the right side of history. My mind is made up that I'm going to serve God with all my heart. Would you bow your heads? With all my heart, my mind, my strength, my soul, my being. God, I know you're real. I know your word is truth. I know, God, that we've come too far, Lord, to turn back. We got to stand. We got to take a stand. We got to be the men and women, young people that, God, that you've called us to be. We got to declare. As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. God, tonight I'm praying that you help us live clean, pure, and holy lives. Lives that will bring glory and honor and praise to you. We bow before you today, God. Lord, we pray together now for our nation, for this upcoming election, Lord. Our hope is not in the White House or the Republican Party. Our hope is not in the Supreme Court. Our hope is in you, Lord. When the righteous rule, the people rejoice. And when the wicked rule, the people mourn. Father, help us tonight, no matter what happens on November the 2nd or 3rd, whatever day that is, no matter what happens, no matter what the results are, you're still God. Jesus, you're still my Savior. Holy Ghost, you're still my power, my fire. Hallelujah. The Lord, you're still coming back. God bless this congregation, these people, these families, touch and strengthen all of our marriages, our homes. Let us be like the founding fathers. Let's stake a claim on the eternal principles of the Word of God. And Father, we'll thank you and we'll praise you. We love you and we glorify you. in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. I will see all of you, good Lord willing, Saturday and then Sunday. And don't forget the prayer march and the what is it, the